this is Graham. Hope everyone's having a great day. This is a video response to a question regarding the use of external flash with the Panasonic FZ100 camera. Although I'm going to answer the question regarding the FZ100, it's probably applicable to most cameras which have a hot shoe accessory on top of the camera. So why would you want to use an external flash unit with a camera that's got a very capable inbuilt flash unit? Well, the internal flash unit does suffer from a couple of limitations. The power of a flash is determined by its guide number, and the guide number is just a mathematical expression of the amount of light available for a given distance. With the inbuilt flash, the range for the flash itself is between 0.3 of a meter and 9.5 meters. It's within that range that the automatic control facilities of the camera can accommodate the amount of light given out by the flash unit. If you wanted to use flash at a greater distance or in a room that doesn't have many reflective surfaces, then the power of the internal flash won't give you enough light. It's then that we need to reach for our external light source to bring us more light into the scene. The second limitation of the internal flash unit is its size. Because it's a very small tube, this acts as a point light source. And when the flashlight is emitted onto our subject, it casts really sharp, defined shadows, and they aren't very flattering at all if you're taking portraits, for example. When you first consider buying an external flash unit for your camera, you may be tempted to go for the dedicated range of flash units for that brand of camera. These can be an expensive option. For example, with the Panasonic range of cameras, the FL flashes vary from about £150 to £250. If you use flash a lot in your photography, then it may be worth considering getting the dedicated unit, as they do give you full automatic control from within the camera. However, if you're just using flash infrequently, like I do, I can't really justify that price when I'm just doing simple setups. To provide me with external flash, I bought a number of external units from eBay. There is a lot of flash units on sale now because of people migrating from their traditional analog cameras to digital, and they've exchanged their cameras and put their accessories up for sale on eBay. This particular flash unit isn't directly compatible with the Panasonic, but it will trigger from the hot shoe. It is a versatile unit in the respect that it can provide me with a bounce facility. It has two auto ranges, which are controlled by a thyristor inside the flash gun. And more importantly, it has a 6-volt trigger. If you are buying an external flash unit from eBay, it's worth checking with a website, which I'll put a link to, which details the trigger voltages for those flash units. Some of the older units use the actual flash working voltage to trigger, and that may be sort of 250 volts. With the modern electronics on these cameras, that would probably fry the electronics, so it's not advisable to use those type of guns. So if you are going to purchase a gun, as I say, check the trigger voltage and make sure that it's suitable for your camera. If you are looking for flash guns on eBay, you may come up with a gem like this. It's a national flash gun. It has a trigger voltage of 10 volts, which is ideal for working with a digital camera, and has two auto ranges plus manual, plus a facility of a bounce flash, so you can angle this up to the ceiling, and also it's got a built-in fill flash. So if you are using the bounce flash, you do get a fill flash to soften those shadows that are created by the overhead bounce flash. So that was a real gem, and you may be able to find those still on eBay. There are quite a lot of hammerhead units, but do check that the trigger voltage is less than 20 volts, or you may run into problems destroying your camera. Another purchase on eBay was this flash unit. I think I paid about £5, including postage, for this one. I couldn't actually find the trigger voltage on the website, so I took a chance. But when I measured the flash trigger voltage, it turned out to be over 200 volts, which is obviously a no-no for the digital camera. But what you can use these units for are slave flash units if you use an optical trigger. So this little unit slips on the hot shoe and provides me with the function of a remote flash unit. So from the main flash, this optical slave trigger picks up that flashlight and then triggers the flash gun by using that flash pulse. So you can set up as many of these around your subject as you want. You might want a main light, a fill light, and a backlight to illuminate your subject. So you can use as many optical triggers as you want to light your subject. One of the advantages of using the external flash unit is the fact that you've raised the flash head higher than the optical centre of the lens. So that means that when you're taking pictures at parties, for example, you're less likely to suffer from people with red eye. Admittedly, The internal unit does have the facility to switch on red eye reduction, which consists of a series of pre-flashes, but after a while your subjects will pre-guess when those flashes will occur and you'll end up with closed eyes rather than red eyes. Once we've mounted our external flash unit on our camera, if we've put on a dedicated unit, then obviously the camera will control all the functions of the flash for you. However, if you've bought a simple flash unit like this one, you do have to set the flash to correspond to the settings you have on your camera. The first one is the ISO. There is on the back of this particular flash unit a scale which I can set to 100. Once I've done that, it tells me the two apertures that I can use which will work within the range of this flash unit. For example, if I want to use close range flash, then I select the blue range, which is from 1 meter to 4.5 meters. Or if I set the red range, it's from 2 meters to 12 meters, but at a lower aperture. Once I've set the aperture range that I want to work with, the flash will then automatically control the amount of light required to give you the perfect exposure. There is the facility on this one as well to switch into manual mode, which actually just covers up the photocell at the front of the flash unit. When you're working with manual, you then have to use the guide number to work out the actual aperture for the distance you're using from the flash. For example, this flash unit has a guide number of 80 feet at ISO 100. So if I'm 10 feet away from my subject, using the rule of divide the guide number by the distance, then I would use F8 in this situation, and that would give me the perfect exposure. Another way to mount your flash on the camera is by the use of a flash bracket. And the flash bracket does give you the advantage that you can mount the flash unit onto the flash bracket and you're not putting the strain onto the hot shoe of the camera. Some of these flash units are quite heavy, and it does worry me that when you're moving the camera around, you are putting an awful amount of torsional force on top of that hot shoe. If you've chosen to use a dedicated unit, you may have the option to use the internal flash unit as a commander module for your external flash. So for example, the Nikon range of SB units and the Canon speed lights do allow you to use the internal flash to command the external flash unit. So if you have chosen a cheaper unit, then you'll have to find some way of connecting the hot shoe of the camera with the hot shoe of the flash unit. So the cheapest way to connect your camera to the flash unit is by the means of a hot shoe adapter system. You'll need a hot shoe to PC adapter on the camera, and then a PC adapter to the hot shoe unit on the flash. So one will be a male adapter which goes on the camera, and the other will be a female adapter that goes onto the hot shoe. So the two component parts you'll require are the male hot shoe adapter, which is from the hot shoe to the PC connector. The second one is the female, which goes from the hot shoe of the flash unit to a plug, which will then plug into the socket on your male adapter. So now we have the flash unit attached to the flash bracket and connected to the camera using our PC connecting cable. Some flash units have a built-in lead, which means that you don't need the female shoe adapter, you just need to plug the end of the cable into your adapter on the camera. If you wanted to move the flash unit further away from the camera, then you can buy extension cables, like this one is a curly coil cable, which does give you the facility to hold the flash at 45 degrees to your subject, 45 degrees pointing down, and that gives you some modelling on your subject. In the previous example of connecting the flash unit to the camera, we used a cable, and that's the old way of doing it. In a modern digital world, we ought to consider using digital technology, and in this case it's a wireless transmitter and a wireless receiver. So the transmitter sits on the hot shoe of the camera, and the camera triggers this transmitter, which sends a wireless pulse over to the receiver, and it's the receiver that then fires the flash unit. That does give us the option that we can move the flash unit to wherever we want within the range of the wireless unit, which in this case is about 100 meters, and we can fire the flash unit directly. One of the things you do come across when you're using flash guns is the harsh shadows that they create. Even with a wider tube, you still get a very directional light source. To overcome those shadows, you can use the flash unit in the bounce mode. But remember that you are now bouncing the light to a ceiling and back to the subject, so the distance increases, so the light power falls off. You have to make compensation from that if you're using a manual gun by opening up your aperture. To overcome that, you can use what's called a diffuser, and there are dedicated diffusers for different types of flash unit, but you can also use kitchen roll, which you can sellotape to your flash unit to have the same effect as the plastic diffusers, and they can create some nice softening effects. If you like to do a lot of portrait photography, then you might want to consider using a flash umbrella, and there are various types of flash umbrellas. One which are the diffusion types, where you fire the flash through the brolly, and others are reflective, and you can get gold or silver ones to add different effects. With the simple ones, like this one here, it's a white umbrella, it's a soft nylon material, so you can either bounce it off the internal surface of the flash, but you lose a lot of power, or you can fire the flash through the umbrella at the subject, and as the flash spreads out and fills the area of the umbrella, you get a much larger light source, which prevents those harsh shadows. So with a couple of these umbrellas, you can achieve some good lighting results. The optical triggers take many different forms. You can have the simple photocell type with a PC connector on the back. This one, for example, is a slave flash unit, which gives you the facility to set the number of pre-pulses before the flash fires. So if you are using a camera that uses pre-flashes, the number of pre-flashes is always fixed, for which the camera then works out the exposure. So if there are 4 pre-flashes, you can set this to fire on the 5th pulse. So it's a useful addition if you have got pre-flash on your camera and can't turn it off. Another flash unit you might want to consider if you do quite a lot of macro photography or wildlife flower photography, then you might want to consider the ring flash. The ring flash isn't a cheap option, but it does give you a lot of advantages in this type of photography. The ring flash has 2 tubes within the ring, and you can vary the power of each ring, so you can achieve modelling results when you're taking your pictures of flowers or models or whatever. So now let's look at some of the pictures taken with the various flash options. Unfortunately, this is a low budget production and I can't afford a model, so you're going to have to put up with my ugly mush. So the first one will be the on-camera flash directly towards the subject without any other additional flash unit. I hope it's apparent from those series of shots that the on-camera flash unit gives very distinct dark shadows, which don't add any interest to the picture at all. When you move the flash off to 45 degrees to the subject and above the subject, you do provide some modelling, but again you start to produce harsh shadows, and they're better when you soften them using a fill-in flash from the side. It's even better if you bounce the light from the umbrella, or if you've no umbrella, if you can use the ceiling. Providing you've got a white ceiling, you can use the bounce flash facility to give you some nice soft effects. You get the advantage that you're also lighting up much of the room, and you get a much more even illumination across your scene. Well, that's the end of this video response. I hope you did find it interesting. If you did, please rate, comment, and preferably subscribe to this channel, where I will bring you further equipment reviews and tips and techniques for the amateur filmmaker. So until then, this is Graham saying bye for now.